Josh, I can't tell you how much I've been looking forward to this day and time, but I got to be honest with you. I've been working this entire morning to try to get my voice down low enough that I can talk to Josh Turner.
Yeah. I can still hear you in your normal register, so you just be you.
what a voice. You must have had some experience in the past singing bass in a gospel quartet somewhere, right?
It was funny because I had always kind of gravitated towards those lower voices, and so our church actually had an older men's quartet, and every time they would sing there at the church, I would just idolize that bass singer. You know, I just thought he was like a superhero to me. And I got to thinking one Sunday, I was like, man, I could find a few other guys my age, and we could start our own quartet. And so that's what we did. We called ourselves the Thankful Hearts. And on some songs, I actually sang the lead, but for most of the songs, I actually sang the bass part because nobody else could hit those low notes.
Man, you do have a low range. Can you remember some of the songs that you sang with that group?
Yeah, we sang songs like Feeling Fine, Anxious for Nothing. Yeah. You know, actually Without Him is actually one of the songs on this record. Sing, yeah. That's actually one of the songs that we would sing, but we would sing all kinds of stuff.
We're in the little town where I was born, and I was telling you earlier, I haven't strayed very far from here, but you also grew up in a small little town.
I did. I never really called it a town because it wasn't really a town. It was more of a farming community there in rural South Carolina. But there was a lot of tobacco farmers in my, lineage.
Was your dad a farmer?
No. He was, I guess, the first one in his family to actually go to college. And the philosophy or the idea, in their minds was that, they wanted to do better than their parents did. Yeah. And they wanted, me and my siblings to do better than they did in life. And that's pretty much what's happened. And it's because they made sacrifices and did what it took to get us to where we needed to be to chase our dreams and chase our passions. And they would push me to get out there, and I would sing at beauty pageants and private parties and anywhere anybody wanted a singer, that they would push me to go out there, because a lot of times I didn't want to. I didn't think it was necessary, but they saw that I needed to hit the ground running and work hard at it and develop myself. So
one of the biggest questions that I get asked, because I've done this for so long, is this: how do you get started? So if you're listening out there, Josh just told you how to get started.
Yeah.
Anytime a door opens.
That's right.
I never forget one time talking with Ben Skill. I said, why do you sing with anybody who asks you to sing? You know what he said? He said, because for so long, nobody asked me. I thought, what a great answer. I know this record is very important to you because of your church background. And I've read your book. And a very interesting book about how your faith has guided you and about everything that you have done. Picking a mate for life, mm-hmm. picking a life's vocation, what kind of songs you're going to sing. And so the hymns were obviously a very important part of where you came from. And they must have inspired you. But at the same time, in inspiring you, you said, I want to write a song myself that says exactly what I want to say.
I mean, I grew up in a traditional church. I grew up in a traditional kind of, home, and there's nothing wrong with tradition. There's a lot of things that tradition has gotten right, and there's a lot of things that we need to base our life on, when it comes to tradition. But I also am a firm believer that things don't need to be the same way all the time. There needs to be creativity. God made us to be creative. And he gave us an incredible mind and an incredible heart and spirit, and we're supposed to use that and to praise and honor him. And so when it came time for me to do this gospel record, I didn't want to just make it, chock full of just the old standards that everybody's heard a million times. And so this one particular day, I had this title written down for a long time, I Serve a Savior. I just thought it had a good ring to it. And we started writing it, and we were like, we need to write like a modern day hymn. And that's exactly what happened. And I even managed to get a little recitation in there. So. Yeah.
I think there is a hole this big in the heart of most men and they don't dare to let anybody know about it. Woman gets in trouble and they say help right away.
Oh, yeah.
A man can be going down for the third time and you say, can I help you? No problem, I got it under control. You're drowning, okay?
Yeah.
You know, and I loved your book because it really talked about real stuff that, you know, that men talk about. It'd be fun to get into some of that today.
Yeah, you know, Man Stuff is a book that I didn't really intend to write. The publisher came to me with that idea, and it terrified me at first because I was like, what in the world am I going to write about? And as we kind of started taking baby steps into it, it started to really excite me because it allowed me the opportunity to just basically kind of sit back and reflect on stories from my life, things that I've learned from, things that I've grown from, you know, advice that I've been given from my heroes, from my parents, grandparents, friends of mine, complete strangers, you know, and there was a lot of funny stuff in the book. It just, there's about 90 stories in this book, but there's just a huge variety of stories in there that were kind of mostly geared towards men, but I feel like anybody and everybody can get something out of this book. But it was geared towards men for, you know, that particular Father's Day that year. And the title actually came from my second son. I've taken all of my boys to my cabin in South Carolina for a kind of a father-son trip. And when I was about to take my second son, Colby, to the cabin, my wife Jennifer asked Colby, she said, what are you and Daddy going to do at the cabin? He said, we're going to do man stuff.
Man stuff.
And so I never forgot him saying that.
That's
and
important,
so
though.
When it came time to title the book, I was like, I know what I'm titling the book. But yeah, you know, speaking to men nowadays, it's just, it's always had a special place in my heart. And I don't consider myself a preacher or even an author for that matter. I know I wrote a book, but I'm not one that can easily put things into words like that to try to teach and instruct somebody. I think I teach better from just the way I live my life and the way I conduct my business and the way I carry myself in the limelight. And so one of my heroes in that aspect is actually John Eldridge, who wrote the book Wild at Heart and different ones.
Is that a great book?
My devotional that I read this morning was an excerpt from his book called Fathered by God, and it talked about how men, whether they had a good earthly father or not, they sometimes fail to realize that we have a heavenly father that wants to fill, you know, and take
boy.
On that role. And so men have this tendency to kind of fall into this rut of striving and indulgences. And that hit me right between the eyes because we're all guilty of that. All of us men are guilty of that. We either strive towards something, you know, from some sort of underlying fear, and then we, you know, try to take part in these small little pleasures along the way, even if we just, you know, sneak away from the crowd and go eat Mexican food or whatever it may be.
Or overeat Mexican food.
Or just, you know, just going to a store and mindlessly buying stuff that we think is going to make us happier or whatever it may be. I think that really kind of spoke to me this morning. And so, you know, I try to steer clear from that. And I try to, you know, set a good example for the men around me too.
I loved your book because you talked about your dad teaching you stuff, but you're trying to teach important stuff also to your kids. Mm-hmm. And one of the things you're trying to teach to them is the whole business of winning and losing. None of us want to teach our kids how to be losers. But we're not being fair to them if we do not teach them there's such a thing called loss in life.
Absolutely.
That they have nothing to do with. For instance, there are 32 teams in the NFL, I think, aren't there? And so only one wins the Super Bowl. So are all the rest of them losers? No, no. I mean, the team I support from time to time, we lose. But our kicking game was good. The passing game was getting better. And you dealt with that in your book with your kids. You said, it's not always about winning and losing. So don't go home tonight just because your team was not ahead at the end of the game and say, I'm a loser. Yeah. To me, that is such a pivotal theological, psychological value to teach to young men, especially. Yeah. To say, son, you need to get acquainted with this because sometimes it's going to happen and you have nothing to do with it.
It's true. It's true. And, you know, the Apostle Paul said to run in such a way as to win the prize. And I think we're all to do that. We're not to just settle for mediocre. We're not, we shouldn't be settling for average. And we shouldn't settle just for losing. Now that's not to say that if you don't win, you have to be a bad sport about it and have a bad attitude and think that you're a failure or you're a you're a loser. It goes back to what I said earlier about the striving and indulging thing. It's like, you know, yes, we're to strive, but we have to understand that we're not always going to get what we want. I've got one out of my four, especially, that when he doesn't win, his world comes crashing down. And I'm dealing with that firsthand right now, you know, and I love seeing that passion in him.
I love
seeing him want something really bad, but I'm having a hard time teaching him that, you know what, it's okay if you don't win all the time. It's hard to express that to, you know, a 7-year-old and for him to understand it. So I'm still trying.
Somebody said there's only two kinds of prayers. Help me, Jesus, and thank you, Jesus.
That's right. I can relate.
Did you ever meet Loretta Lynn?
I did. She had heard Long Black Train and loved it. Well, I think I was at the CMT Awards and she had gone up to every young male country singer that she could find, and every one that she would see, she'd go up to him. She didn't know who sang Long Black Train, but she was bound to find out. And so she would go up to every one of them. She'd go up to Keith Urban. She'd go up to different ones. Oh, I just love that Long Black Train. I'm sorry, that's not my song. Until she finally, like her daughters finally directed her to me. And so she finally got to meet me. But I got my picture with her that night and everything. But it was just so funny. But she had finally found the guy that sang Long Black Train.
Okay, Josh, you're looking at the biggest Hank Williams fan ever from the beginning. Mainly because of his writing. To me, I still think one of the greatest songs ever written is Hear That Lonesome Whippoorwill, It Sounds Too Blue to Fly.
Oh, yeah.
The midnight train is whining low. I'm so lonesome I could cry. He must have experienced some depression in his life to write a song with that much passion. So back again to man stuff.
Yeah.
It's great when real men say, hey,
oh yeah,
I got kicked in the stomach and it hurt.
Oh yeah, yeah.
But well, he could express it, couldn't he?
He didn't try to overcomplicate things. He kept things very simple.
Very simple.
He got right to the heart of the matter, and that's the way it is with this song. I saw the light. You know, he just basically talks about how, you know, he was going through a time, or at least the singer in the song is going through a time of like he's rejecting the truth. He's rejecting the Lord. He's rejecting the goodness that he can bring. And he just talks about how he's gone through this rough spot where he's pushed everything away. But finally, after some time and going through this journey, he finally gets it. He finally opens his eyes and sees what it's all about. And but the interesting thing to me, I've always loved Hank's version of this song, but every version since then, to me, just sounds like, you know, some song that somebody would get a tambourine and jump around a campfire or something. You know, it's just some big happy song. But to me, when you read the lyrics, there's redemption in this song, but this guy's, he's gone through hell and back to try to get to where he is.
Where he saw the light.
And so I was toiling over this song, trying to figure out how I was going to go in and record this song. And so I'm proud of this, the way it came out. And I, you know, I would like to think that Hank would be proud of it too. So
in our field, there was an old pioneer by the name of Jake Hess. He sang in a group back in the 60s. And he said something to me when I first got married that I'll never forget. And it reminded me a little bit about your dinners that you used to have with Eddie Arnold. He gave you wisdom. But Jake would say, Bill, when the lights are burning brighter on the stage than they are at home, you're in trouble.
Yeah.
And in reading your book, first of all, you had some wonderful models in your mother and father, and evidently in your grandparents. Mm-hmm. So you're blessed.
I am.
A lot of kids don't have those kind of models. But in reading your book, I was telling Gloria, this is about too good to be true. This kid is serious about life. He's serious about his what he does.
Sometimes a little too serious.
And you know, and in a world that is the music world can be pretty cynical. You know.
Oh yeah.
You know. But here's somebody that what you see is what you get, and your wife is important. Your kids are important to you. Which kind of leads to the meat of why this song was attractive to you. Without him, I could do nothing. By the way, it's written by a good friend of mine, Mylon Lefevre.
Yeah.
In fact, we need to get him on the phone after the interview. Yeah. You would love him.
He's become a friend of mine, too.
Oh, you know Mylon?
Yeah.
What a great, great heart.
I came to know him through the book because I had talked about the song in the book, and we had to get, I guess I had quoted some of the lyrics, and we had to get permission.
Yeah.
And so when somebody from the book publisher called his music publisher number, he answered the phone.
Yeah.
And I guess he handles all his publishing.
Is he fun to talk to on the phone?
He is.
I tell you, every time I talk with him, he always leaves me with some scripture that he's read, that some inspiring thing about life.
Well, he's got some energy.
Yeah, he's got some energy. So this song became very meaningful to you.
Yeah. I loved the song from the first time I heard it. Like I said, when I was in my quartet, my young men's quartet in church, we sang this song, and so the lyric made an impression on me from the first time I heard it. But at some point, I was like, I want to know, what's the story behind this song? And so when I got to looking for it, I found out that Mylon was stationed at Fort Jackson in Columbia, South Carolina. I think he was 17 years old or something. He was in the Army. And so he writes this song by himself, and obviously his family is a gospel group, the Singing Lefevres, and so they had a gig booked in Memphis. So he hitchhikes from Columbia, South Carolina to Memphis, Tennessee. He's cold, he's wet, he's dirty, he's hungry, he's ornery, he gets there and he tells his mama, he's like, I'm going to the hotel, take a nap, I'm going to shower, get ready. And she said, well, while you're doing that, she said, do you have any new songs or anything that you want to sing tonight? And he said, well, I got one. And so he played it for them, and they, started working on it and everything. And so he comes back for the show, and they go out and they do this song without him. And lo and behold, there's a guy that's also on the show, standing on the side of the stage, by the name of Elvis Presley.
Yeah.
And he's listening to this song, and I think he ended up cutting that song 2 weeks later or something.
Sure.
And Elvis actually let Mylon have the publishing.
I've been through that.
Yeah, and it changed his life.
Yeah.
And I think there's been almost 200 people that have cut this song since Elvis did it.
Sure.
And so I fell in love even more with the song after I heard the story, because it was just such an incredible story. Once again, it was God's way of getting, that song out there to the masses. And so this is a song that I've sung in church. I've sung this to my boys many, many nights, as I put them down to bed, when they were real small babies. And so this song's always, meant something to me.
I see a bus in your future where you could go out and sing harmony all across the country. And let's see how well my memory is. Marion, right?
Right.
Hawk.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Jennifer. Yeah. Kobe.
Colby.
Colby.
Yep. C-O-L-B-Y.
Colby. Yep. Hampton.
There you go. That's pretty good.
And I'm Josh.
What's your name?
It's like me and him are the only difference is the body, because everybody calls him Marion and me Colby.
They do?
Yeah, they're like switch our names.
They're like, hey,
every single
they're
time.
Like, hey Marion, hey Colby. And they get them mixed up.
Well, you know what? You look like a Marion to me from the very beginning. Yeah. Yeah. You like that name?
I do.
Yeah. What grade of school are you in?
I'm going into second.
Second
I'm
grade.
In first.
I remember the second grade.
And I've been third grade math.
Third grade. I enjoyed that both times. That's a joke, Marion.
I was like,
no. Kobe, is he a good daddy?
He is.
Why do you say that? Why do you say he's a good daddy? What does he do with you?
He plays songs and he gives us food and...
Does he teach you how to fish?
He does.
Who's the best fisher person?
He didn't teach me how much.
Okay.
He didn't teach you how to fish?
He doesn't teach you how to fish?
I taught you a little bit, but we'll keep working on it.
You got a fishing pole?
You still got to get it out of the trees.
It's okay. You got a fishing pole?
You got to get it out of the trees.
Put your microphone on.
Yeah, I got a fishing pole.
Yeah, you do have a fishing pole.
And Jennifer, you two met where?
Belmont.
At Belmont. What year of school were you in?
I had transferred from Francis Marion University in South Carolina.
Yeah.
I had done my first 2 years there. And a lot of stuff didn't transfer, so I had to do 3 more years at Belmont.
Really?
But she and I met... she only did 4 years at Belmont, but then she...
I was smarter, so I got...
Yeah, here we go. Here we go. I was hoping to get through that part without her bringing that up. She had to go get her master's from University of Georgia, so she moved back home while I was finishing up at Belmont, but she needed more education.
Here we go.
And you're both music majors, mm-hmm. Of some kind or other. Do you ever sing with him?
We do. We don't sing as... I was on the road with him and played in his band and sang background vocals full time until this one was born. Just felt like it was time for me to be home a little bit more. Yeah. But every once in a while, I'll still jump on the Opry, or if I get to go on a show and I've got somebody out there to watch them on the side of stage, I'll jump in for a song or two.
One of the hardest things to do in this field, and Gloria and I, we taught school for 10 years, but when our things started catching on and we started going out and traveling, I said, either that telephone's going to control me or I'm going to control it. You have to learn how to say no, right?
Well, it's worse nowadays because it's not just a telephone. It's a email contraption and texting and everything else. And you definitely have to learn how to balance it. There's some days where I literally get fed up with it and I just want to throw it in my pond. I'm just kind of focused on my goals, but I don't let those goals... I don't lose sight of what's most important because of my goals, if that makes sense.
And you have to do that very, very carefully.
Yeah.
And there's no cookie cutter answer, because this one's different than this one. This one's different than that one. And let me tell you something, there's joy in all of it. We've asked our kids from time to time, what are the pluses and the minuses? And they have said, there are definitely some pluses and there are definitely some minuses in growing up in a home like this. And there will be. I think your kids will say the same thing.
I'm friends with John Anderson, country artist, and I won't ever forget the story he told me one time. He had two girls, has two girls, and he said when they were really young, he would leave to go out on the road, and they would just leave him there at the door, just crying their eyes out. Daddy, why do you have to leave? Daddy, why do you have to leave? And he said, it just tore my heart out. And he said, baby, he said, I got to go make money. And so he said, when they got to be teenagers, they didn't cry anymore. They were like, Daddy, go make us some money. He said, it just changed all of a sudden.
Yeah, Hawk has had all the fun that he wants with this. We'll see you later, babe. Balancing a career and raising a family. Nothing's easy. Nothing's easy. Except I can remember with my dad, he worked what we called the second trick at General Motors. he would go in at 3:30, 4 in the afternoon. So when we come home from school, he was leaving for work. Hmm. And when we get up in the morning, he would still be sleeping because he had to work till 12, 1 o'clock, wow, at 2 o'clock in the morning, you know. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there's always pluses and minuses in anything that your daddy does. So be very, very kind to him, okay, Kobe? You listening? He's done the best he can do. It's the first time he's ever done this. He's done the best job he can do.
That's true.
You would be a country singer?
I was thinking of doing that. I wanted to do three things.
What you want to do?
Be a baseball player, sing, and be what Colby wants to be, a herpetologist.
A herpetologist.
They study about animals.
He came to me a couple months ago, very upset, and saying, I don't know how I'm going to be everything I want to be when I grow up. He's seven. And I said, well, let's talk about this. I said, what do you want to be? He said, I don't know how I'm going to play baseball for the Braves and then go on the road and sing like Daddy and be a herpetologist. And I said, a what?
A herpetologist.
So, Colby, you want to be a herpetologist. You need to tell Mr. Bill what a herpetologist
is. Tell me what a herpetologist is.
It's a study about amphibian and reptiles.
Oh, so it's a specialized kind of a animal, yeah. And Hampton, what do you want to be?
I want to do a lot of things, but I don't think I can do every one of them.
I got an idea for you. Why don't you be the manager of those two?
Hopefully I won't be too bossy. You won't be too.
What attracted you to this sweet man here?
First thing was his eyes. You don't find those eyes just anywhere walking down the street. So those were pretty attracting. But he was always a good listener, and he was a friend. And when we realized there might be more, we started, you know, kind of searching our hearts and searching each other inadvertently to see where the meat was. And I realized that his values were the same as mine.
How long did you know him before you actually started dating?
Well, it was 6 months before she even called me her boyfriend. So
we
took it pretty slow because, you know, like she was saying earlier, you know, she and I both had our hearts broken. So we weren't really ready to rush into anything. We still had some healing to do. And
we knew each other for a good, year and a half before that, mm-hmm, at least.
Yeah.
But after the relationship I was in ended, my prayer was that if I met someone during that interim, he would be willing to wait until I felt like I knew who I was and my heart was healed, because I didn't want to go into a relationship with half of me. And he waited.
She's worth waiting for.
So.
That's sweet. You know, two halves don't make a whole.
That's right.
And so you're smart. That was smart for you to do that. I've got a good friend, Jeff Easter. He and Sherry sing together as a gospel music team. He said, Sherry and I have never had any arguments. We just have intense moments of fellowship.
We're both pretty strong-willed, so you can imagine.
Yeah. We are.
Yeah.
We created several more strong-willed. We didn't create, but the Lord gave us a few. Several strong-willed individuals, but I think that kind of, in a lot of ways, that prepares us for what we're doing. I mean, he wouldn't be the same man he was when I married if he wasn't strong-willed.
Absolutely.
He stayed true to who he is, and it takes a lot of tenacity to stay in this business and to stay married and to be happily married.
Absolutely.
And to still stay grounded and find time for each other, and we strive to do that now. We don't strive to do it tomorrow or in the future.
Yeah.
You know, some months we're better at it than others, but it's always on the forefront of both of our minds.
And secondly, when those moments come up, talk about them. Mm-hmm. And can I tell you something? In this last 10 years, we've learned another secret. When we get on the phone and we're upset about something, we say, let's call back and lower our voice about 5 or 6 notes. You could use that one of these days.
Yes.
let's just lower our voices and discuss this about 5 or 6 notes.
Yeah.
Lower. you know. Is that a good mommy?
She is.
Why do you say that? Why is she such a good mommy?
Because she takes care of us a lot, and she fixes our food, and she lets us have a lot of privileges.
Does she charge you for the food?
She does.
Jennifer, tell me about the song, The River.
Hampton and I wrote it 2 or 3 years ago. I went to stay at a family friend's who I call my aunt's, their farm, to see the boys could see the baby lambs and so mama could sleep.
Yeah.
But while we were there, I started struggling with some health challenges about that time, and I got sick and he was sick. We were in the hospital one night with him, and all that to say, I could not sleep very well when I was there. Yeah. And one day they were just messing around on their instruments like they do a lot. And I noticed Hampton was playing something I hadn't heard on his mandolin. And I said, what are you playing? He was like, something I just made up. I said, that's how you write a song. I said, what's it about? What do you see? And I kind of started probing him. He was like, well, I don't know. I said, well, think about it. Put some thought into it and let's write it. And he said, well, it's about a river. I said, what kind of river? Is it a happy river? A sad river? Is it a busy river? He said, it's a happy river. And so he kind of started writing that melody, and we just kind of lived with it for a little while. I didn't really write many words then at that point. But that night, I couldn't sleep because I was sick and he was sick and I was anxious about it. And during the night, I just wrote the rest of the song. I'm not at the piano. I was in the dark, but I just grabbed the littlest sheet of paper I could find there in the basement and just wrote it. Came really quickly and easily, and when he got up the next morning, I said, I think I just wrote the rest of the song, and we put it together, and they performed it for the first time, performing anything together. That was the first one they did. And so fast forward to the end of the school year this past year, and we homeschool, and we were learning about hymns, and that a hymn doesn't have to be, written 200 years ago. Mm-hmm. And so I said, why don't we just sing it? And when we sang it, we hadn't sung it in a while. Their voices were older, and I had my phone. So I was like, I'm just going to record it. Well, I sent it to him, who happened to be in a meeting with his producer for this record at the time. And he was like, oh, my word, I think I got to put that on the album. And Josh doesn't put things on his album lightly. And I knew it was special to him, and it meant something to him, because I don't think he would have, I know he wouldn't have done it otherwise. And so therefore it became really neat for us, and for Hampton, being the first song he ever really dabbled in with songwriting. He's written more since then.
A lot more.
But it's just really special, for us to have done that together, and for Josh to get to put it on his first gospel album.
Is it true that you sang this song, The Long Black Train, on the Opry? Did you sing it before you got before it was on a record, or had you recorded it?
I hadn't even recorded it yet.
And you sang? Now that is very seldom done. So yeah. You told the folks, hey folks, here is a new song, right?
It took me a lot of years to understand the significance of my Opry debut. 2001 was an incredible year for me. I started dating my wife in early 2001. I graduated from Belmont in August, I think, of 2001, and then I signed my publishing deal in October of 2001. I signed my record deal in November of 2001, and then I made my Opry debut in December of 2001. And so here I was. I basically had to beg my way onto the Opry stage. My manager at the time, Jody Williams, and I had gone to Pete Fisher, the general manager of the Opry, and basically begged him for me to go on. And he finally relented. He was like, you know what? I'll just let you go on late one Friday night before Christmas, and sing one song with the staff band late in the show.
Throw you to the wolves.
Yeah. And so I was like, hey, that's fine by me. And so the only song that we had rehearsed with the staff band was Long Black Train. I had given them a chart of a demo that I had done of it. It wasn't even the record version. I hadn't even recorded my record yet. I didn't have a a video. Nobody knew who Josh Turner was, and that's kind of what I'm getting at, is that I go out and I sing this song, and about halfway through the first pass of this song,
they start applauding.
People start standing up, people start clapping and stomping the floor, and I mean, by the end of the song, the whole crowd was on their feet. They're chanting, they're clapping and everything, and I leave, I wave goodbye, you know, and I'm going back to my dressing room.
And they call you back.
And I had already started my way up the steps, and they're, you know, people are calling for me. Bill wants you back out on stage. And I'm like, for what? I don't have any more songs to play. And so
you sang it again?
I started the song over again from the top. And somewhere in that first or second verse, I just completely, like, I got overwhelmed with emotion. And I got choked up. And I lost my place. I started singing all over the place. The band doing their darndest to try to follow me and figure out where I'm at. Well, that became a historic night because nobody had ever seen anything like that since Hank Williams had made his debut, where he, and that's all I could think about that night was, really? I'm standing in the same spot that Hank stood during his debut. He got six or seven encores from Love Sick Blues. I'm looking up at the same balcony and standing on the same stage and everything. Yeah. I was overcome with the gravity of this.
So were you in the Ryman or the new?
I was at the Ryman.
Yeah. That's the place. Yeah.
And so at some point it finally hit me why everybody was so enamored with that night. And it dawned on me, it was like, nobody knew who Josh Turner was. I didn't have a record. I didn't have a website. I hadn't done a photo shoot. I hadn't done a video.
That's amazing.
I hadn't done any kind of press of any kind. I was fresh out of college. I had just signed my record deal like a month prior to that night. That's when it finally dawned on me, like, why it was so genuine and so emotional that night, was because it was strictly because of the song and just my delivery of it. Like, that's what just got people going that night.
You know what we call those kind of things in our world, and I think you'd agree, a God thing.
Yeah, it was. It was.
You had the honor of playing the part of George Beverly Shea in a movie about Billy Graham's life. What was it called? Billy Graham, The Early Years?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It was kind of odd to get a call like that, but because I don't consider myself, you know, some hotshot actor. I try to focus mostly on my music and my singing and everything. But if the right movie role comes along, yeah, and I have the time for it, I'll jump into it. And so this one was kind of cool for me because I was like, man, you know, this is going to allow me the opportunity to honor somebody who it was like, you know, a superhero in gospel, in the gospel world.
Yeah.
You know, Billy Graham and George Beverly Shea, I mean, you can't get much bigger than that. Yeah. And so the hardest part for me was trying to sing and talk with a slight Canadian accent, because I found out he was from Canada. I was like, oh boy, I'm really going to be acting now. It was a low budget thing. But it was still fun to portray him, and it was just kind of cool to be, you know, a part of that project. You know, it was basically kind of telling the story of Billy Graham before people came to know who Billy Graham was. Yeah. And so, you know, like I say, it was a small part. There was some singing involved, and it was fun. Armie Hammer played the part of Billy Graham, and after that movie, he just took off. He's been in all kinds of, you know, big movies, and I tell people that I taught him everything he knows.
Josh, I had the privilege of interviewing Bev Shea on his 99th birthday, and I'll never forget saying, Bev, you're 99 today, right? He said, yes, and if you turn it upside down, I'm 66.
I heard that he acted like a young man. Even
he
in
was
his
amazing.
Older age.
You know what? He lived until he was 104, and he was totally, fully alive for 104 years. He told me he saw this song on manuscript paper in England back probably in 53, 54, 55, the mid 50s, somewhere. Mr. Klein had just written it. He wrote the lyric. The music, I think, was public domain. But he had written the music, They introduced it there, and then they brought it to Madison Square Garden and was in Madison Square Garden for every night for 6 months. That's even more than Billy Joel.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, is that amazing? And he said he sang that song every night. You know, I call this maybe the first big praise and worship song of the last century. In the churches today, we talk a lot about praise and worship. But the greatest one was this one. And when I think that God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burdens gladly bearing,
yeah.
He bled and died to take away my sin. What a great, great song.
So you're so good at that, because I can't recite lyrics. I have to sing them, because I can't think of what they are if I just talk. But How Great Thou Art, obviously, is a song that most everybody knows, whether you're a Christian or not. And this is one of those songs that I had considered. And I did change a few lyrics within this song, but it was just literally one or two or three. And I even toyed with the idea of changing it to How Great You Are, because that's how we would say it nowadays.
Yeah, yeah.
But I was like, I can't change
you
this.
You probably should have
like,
done
I was
that.
Like,
wise decision.
Yeah, yeah, my life would be in danger if I did that. There's just some things you don't mess with.
I have so much respect for country writers. First of all, they are extremely creative and clever. But I love what they do, even on gospel subjects, because they can take more risk, I guess, than gospel, right? We have to make sure our these and thous and everything's correct. They can write songs like, they baptized Jesse Taylor in Cedar Creek last Sunday. Jesus gained a soul and Satan lost a good right arm. They all cried hallelujah when Jesse's head went under. This time he went under for the Lord. It just seemed like they look into another window when they look at the gospel. So I have so much respect for him. But you are an interesting case here where you're not a gospel writer or you're not a gospel singer as such, but you are a Christian person who sings country music. I think it's fantastic.
Well, and we country artists are allowed to be grammatically incorrect too, so we have a lot more freedom. Hence the song Me and God. But hey, don't let grammar get in the way of a good song.
Yeah, you are
right?
A good song, never.
So I've had a lot of people ask me, why didn't you get into gospel music? Why didn't you become a Christian contemporary singer or what have you? And the answer is pretty simple. I tell them that God called me to be a country singer.
Absolutely.
And that's where my heart's always been. Yeah. That's what I've always loved. I've been a student of country music from a very early age, but I grew up in a Christian home. I grew up going to church. I grew up reading the Bible, and I've had a lot of spiritual experiences in my life that have kind of defined me and my life and my path, you know, that I've been on. I've always been a realist. Like, the things that I tell you are things that I'm 110% sure of. I don't say, well, I think this, or I believe this. I have to kind of know. Now, obviously, being a Christian, you know, a lot of who we are is based on faith, and I get that. You know, there's a lot of things that we humans can't comprehend, we don't understand, and we may never understand. I feel like, you know, God is far bigger than us. He's far wiser than us, and there's just things that, you know, I mean, and I think that's honestly why we don't know a lot about what heaven is or is like, because I don't think we can really grasp it. But when it comes to the way I kind of express myself and the way I tell people about who I am and what I'm about and what my beliefs are, I try to just be as real about it as I possibly can, because I feel like non-believers and non-Christians are looking for that. They don't want some, you know, holy roller kind of thing, you know, or they don't want to be preached to, you know, they want things in simple terms, and they want things broken down so to where they can understand it. And so when I wrote Me and God, I feel like people can get too complex about things, where if they would just be more simple and break things down.
It really is not that complicated.
No, if you break things down into layman terms, I feel like you can win a lot of people over. And I remember Dr. Ralph Stanley came in and sang on this song, which was a huge honor for me.
Boy, when I heard that voice, I didn't have to ask whose voice was that.
Not at all. And I had a few of the guys from Diamond Rio come in and sing harmonies on this song. And I won't ever forget Dana from Diamond Rio, when he was reading the lyrics, where it was like, early in the morning, talking it over, me and God, late at night, talking it over, me and God. You could say we're like two peas in a pod, me and God. And he just thought that was hilarious. And I was like, well, it's true, though. You know, and there's only so many words that rhyme with God, by the way. I'll put that out, too.
You know, I've used sod before and nod, but the peas in the pod.
There was a line in there about where the angels trod.
We always use trod.
The alternate title to me and God is Joshua and Yeshua.
Your book is an easy read, and I think it's a book that men especially ought to read, because I think they're trying to identify with something that can help them through their day. But in one of the chapters, you talked about a vision. Mm-hmm. That's a stretch for some folks. Tell us about it.
It is, and you know, like I said earlier, you know, I'm a realist, and so this is not something that I think I saw. It wasn't some stormy night, There was a lot of lightning flashing and all that stuff. It was a pretty calm night. My daddy and I had left the house to take the trash off. This was back before you had recycling centers and all that. We had a trash dumpster, you know, right in front of the country store, right down from our house. And so we left the house and dumped the trash. And between the store and our house, there was this big wide open field. And I remember driving to the trash dump, and the sky was pretty clear. And I didn't see the moon anywhere, but it was pretty clear night. And we dumped the trash, and on the way back to the house, I'm sitting in the passenger seat, my daddy's driving, and I see this light start reflecting off of the hood, and I'm thinking, I don't remember seeing the moon earlier. So I felt something like kind of pull my upper body towards the windshield, and I looked out, and there's this single cloud hovering over the branch back behind my house, and it's lit up, and there's this figure of a man in a white robe, just standing on the cloud with his arms stretched out. And there was no definition or anything. It was just pure light coming from this cloud, and like I say, it was the figure of a man standing there with his arms stretched out. And I'm pretty young boy. I don't even think I'm a teenager yet. I'm viewing this for what seemed like an eternity, but it was just a few seconds. And then I felt something pull my body back into the seat, and then I watched the light fade away off the hood. Well, I wanted so badly to tell my daddy what I had just seen, but I could not utter a word. We get home, and I run out to my daddy's barn, find a pad of paper and a pencil, and I drew what I had seen so I wouldn't forget it, and didn't tell anybody for a long time, and finally worked up the nerve to tell my parents what I had seen, because I was scared to tell anybody, because I thought they would just think I was crazy. They'd think I was seeing things, you know, the whole nine yards. And so I told them. They believed me. I eventually started telling other people at church, and word spread to my school that I had seen this. And then I started getting mocked and made fun of, and, you know, people were calling me Jesus boy and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, that stuff didn't really faze me, because I knew what I had seen. I didn't go and change my mind just because somebody was making fun of me. I knew what I'd seen. And the biggest question in my mind was, okay, Lord, why did I see this? Why did you allow me to see this? What is this all about? And the only answer I ever got back from that question was to to let you know I exist.
Not bad.
And of course, as a young boy, I wanted more than that. I wanted a bigger, more explained answer. But as I started going through life, I started going through philosophy classes in college, you know, where they would challenge your beliefs and challenge your faith and, you know, come up with, they would be the devil's advocate and try to argue with you on this and that and the other. And moving away from home, having people you love, you know, leave you and you know, the loss that you were talking about yep. earlier, you know, that life, you know, tends to hand you from, you know, from every sure. angle, seems sure. like. I kept clinging to that vision. No matter what kind of, you know, adversity I would face, or no matter how far down I thought I was getting, no matter how much doubt I was experiencing in any kind of situation in my life, I would always go back to that and remember that He exists. He's real. And so when I sing a gospel song, I'm not just singing a song. I'm singing about something that I know for a fact is real. And I've just encountered so many stories and things that I've heard and things that I've read that just continue to just add to the validity of, you know, what the Bible says and the fact that there is a God and he had a son named Jesus that came to earth to die for our sins and he conquered the grave. And so when I sing, you know, a gospel song, I'm not just up there just to sing a gospel song. I'm singing about something that I know in my heart that's real. So when I sing Amazing Grace, you know, I'm singing about a grace that I know is freely offered to us and that can be given to us on any given day. And this is not just some, you know, good idea that John Newton had when he wrote it. You know, it's a song about, you know, the Lord and how He loves us.